Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Hangout with VCs event, brought to you by Scale Up Porto and Startup Amsterdam. My name is Maurer, and I'm an editor at TNW, and I'll be your host for today. We're here today to foster connections between two ecosystems. We want to help each other grow by sharing challenges and opportunities across cities. And the ultimate goal is to develop a stronger pan-European startup ecosystem. In order to do that, we're connecting 30 innovative startups from Porto and Amsterdam with a carefully selected group of international investors who will listen to the startups' pitches today. We're joined today by two investors from Amsterdam and Porto. They will help us to get to know the ecosystems a bit better. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome to the stage Johan van Mil and Adao Oliveira. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning, Mar.
Good morning. Now, perhaps you could start us off, Johan, and tell us a bit about Peak Capital and your role there.
Yeah, sure. Thanks for having me, by the way. I'm Johan van Mil, founder and managing partner of Peak Capital. We are Amsterdam-based capital fund. For the Netherlands, a pretty big fund, but for Europe, of course, a smaller fund, 66 million euro, sorry. Investing in startups, mainly focusing on SaaS companies, marketplaces, and platforms. We invest tickets between 250k and 2.5 million euro. And I think what's different in our fund is that we are truly an entrepreneurial-led, but also a funded fund. So I think all the famous entrepreneurs you probably know, the Netherlands, like the guys Booking and Argent, invested in our fund. And also my track record, by the way, is also as an entrepreneurial, I've also have an entrepreneurial background, starting and selling and buying 11 companies. And given our track record, we did 28 investments to date, closing one today. As we all know, had 10 exits so far, but also zero failures. So somehow we found a good way to find some interesting companies to invest in.
Ah, that's great. Although people seem to really love failures online, so they're always writing about that. And you, Adao, what are you and Portugal Ventures working on at the moment?
Yeah. Thanks for having me. As a bit of background for the audience of Portugal Ventures, Portugal Ventures is one of the top VC firms in Portugal and an investor that I'm with for almost 10 years now. Although along the way, I had a break of 6 months in a VC in Madrid. Additionally, and that is something that deserves to be highlighted in my opinion, Portugal Ventures team is the one that is in the market for more years now here in Portugal. So Portugal Ventures is focused on the seed and early stages of investment, and that comprehends from pre-seed until Series A plus. So this means ranging from as little as 50,000 euros until 1.5 to 2 million. In terms of investment focus, we are pre-agnostic, I must say. Indeed, we have four investment divisions that are digital, engineering and manufacturing, life science, and tourism. So we have pretty much everything covered, in my opinion. So in our portfolio, we have 130 companies, and we have almost 200 million assets under management. So most known investments include Defined Crowd, Aptoid, Barkin, Lovish, that just yesterday announced a new round of funding of 17 million euros, bringing together Portuguese, French, and Danish investors. And so indeed, these 10 years with Portugal Ventures allowed me to saw the evolution of Portuguese landscape, and I must say it looks better than ever. But for sure, we'll have the opportunity to deep dive in that in a minute. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and sorry for this.
No problem. Now, it's good things are doing well, but now there's obviously been a lot of changes in every single ecosystem around the world in the past 12 months. But I'm curious to know from you, Johan, what kind of activity an investor who is scoping out Amsterdam would see today?
Yeah, I think a few things. I think the pandemic makes us, I think, all realize how valuable personal contact is, right? What we have with each other and to meet and to talk live, but also to hug people that we know and value a lot. I think we all struggle also in VC land, but also as Peak Capital, with that open society where it's not where you can freely move. And in the Netherlands currently, probably tonight it will be announced as an evening clock so that we just stay inside.
All curfew.
very bizarre, like for a liberal community as the Netherlands is, as you probably know. So that's I wonder how that works. And I think we all realize also as investors, you know, the massive changes it brings daily to our work, right? From having a lot of meetings and having a lot of cup of coffee and meeting people around, and shifting to, you know, webinars like these, but also Zoom meetings, and spending a lot of time behind your computer and behind your phone. So I think that's really changed. I think what it also brought to us, and I think we as T Capital were always a little bit strict on that, is that we realized that talking about health also in this case, that for companies and for startups, healthy unit economics are really important. Because I think you see a big shift now in the space of investing. I think on the one hand, you will see companies more or less losing the game because they found out they are not the real painkillers and their vitamins and are struggling a little bit to get some growth numbers good and facing serious headwinds and try to overcome them with bridge round and labor cuts, etc. So I think that's on the one hand happening. On the other hand, what's happening in the market, and you see that also, I think, recently in the news, is there's also a group, a smaller group, which is really winning this game. And which is really having a lot of tailwinds and see a lot of growth because they're really proven to be a painkiller and proven to be to have a very good growth rate these times. And I think what you see in our space then particularly is that, of course, the number of VCs stays more or less the same, and even though big funds are raising, so the committed capital is really big, but there are less companies to be interesting in. So I think a lot of VCs, of course, jump on these interesting companies. So you see the valuations there going up, of course, and the companies which are doing not so well going down and taking losses and creating a new labor market, which I think, by the way, is really good also for the market. But of course, it's not so nice for the founders involved. And on the other hand, what you see is that new companies are started because they see the need for adaption, the need for change, and they're flexible and also new in working. So they create new business models and new ways to take profit from the current changes, both in society, but also in the recession where which we are heading. So I think it's threefold what's happening in the market right now. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there seems to be kind of a congregation around certain startups. So instead of having a broad market, you're kind of gathering around the certain winners along with new innovative startups coming into the scene that are more adapted to the current reality.
Yes, correct.
Yeah. Yeah. And how about Porto DAO? Are the trends there that you're seeing there in line with what's happening elsewhere in Europe and the rest of the world?
So first things first, I was speaking on behalf of Porto, but indeed what I'll be saying for Porto is really applicable for Lisbon, Braga, Coimbra, and so forth. So in my opinion, our competitive advantages remain solid, even after all the COVID situation. And that is also true because indeed Portugal, in what regards VC activity, somehow it is a late entrant in the global market. So it has its own advantages for now. So in short, those competitive advantages are, I would say, a developed local market. So allowing for business model validation at a reduced cost. Companies have a go global mindset since their first day because of Portugal market size, basically, and also important entrepreneurial hubs like Lisbon, Porto, Braga, and Coimbra. And they are so relatively close from all major cities in Europe, I would say 2 to 3 hours flight maximum. Mm-hmm. The other thing will be the availability of low-cost talent and also shipping, living, and life costs. So this is high capital efficient, but We still need some international talent regarding sales and marketing because our engineering folks and teams, they are very good, but not so good in terms of sales and marketing. And this is something that I would like to highlight. So eventually, if someone is thinking about, you know, coming to Portugal and has this kind of skills, that will be very valued here in Portugal. The other thing, in my opinion, it's a relatively low valuation. And what this means is we have a maturing ecosystem, but still with a discount. And as we move forward, this tends to disappear. And this is related to what I said in the beginning, the fact that we are somehow a late entrant in the market, it allows for, you know, more reduced valuations, let's put it that way. So it's a buyer's market, meaning supply exceeds demand and giving purchasers an advantage over sellers in negotiation. The other thing, and I would say probably this is likely also for Netherlands and all countries in Europe, that is public incentives on innovation. So leverage the equity investment with long-term non-dilutive state and regional grants, R&D tax breaks, etc. And last but not least, more startups growing faster and achieving higher multiples. And this contributes for the creation of a real ecosystem where network effects start to be more tangible. And so this brings also more investors to the landscape. And this is my view on it. Yeah.
Yeah. But you also have a pretty broad portfolio, and you mentioned tourism startups, which is what I've seen a lot from Portugal. I mean, surely the market has changed a bit with the pandemic. So are you seeing any shift also within Portugal, or are you seeing more new initiatives that are directly addressing pandemic type life? Or
I won't say, Mar, not really. But uh-huh. In what regards to tourism, of course, we are facing a serious issue right now. I think we all around the world are adapting ourselves to this, and eventually what might happen in the next 6 months, 1 year, nobody really knows. But still, in what regards to tourism, we have at this moment a call open, where we are trying to see new solutions around tourism startups. Mm-hmm. So it's a challenge, of course, but eventually something brand new might flourish from this threat of the COVID and also all the pandemic situation.
Now, but also both of you have frequent interactions with other ecosystems and know the challenges of entering unknown ecosystems. So what kind of challenges do you think outside investors might face in Amsterdam and Porto? And do you have any advice for them how to overcome them? So maybe if we start with you, Johan, you have also a bit of insights into the Nordics. So how do you think your entering to the Nordics compares to other investors entering into Amsterdam?
Yeah, of course, I talk about Amsterdam, but I think this also matters for the Netherlands, right? I think from the one end to the other end, it makes a three-hour drive. So it's pretty compact country, as we all know. I think, you know, we as Dutchies, we are native international thinkers. I think the same for Portugal guys. So everybody speaks English, and everybody, you know, when they start a company, they think that beyond their own borders, because the home market is really too small to be successful. And I think that's one thing which is really, really relevant. I think the second one is that the Dutch people have really an entrepreneurial background. You know, the first stock market was from Amsterdam in, I believe, around 1600, helping the ships all over the world, buying stuff, etc. And it's really liberal. So also, you know, in terms of, I think we all know that it paves the way for the legalizing drugs, but also for the health issues, but also for the self-control issues like life decisions like euthanasia. Netherlands really now. So it's a very open, liberal, transparent, tolerance culture. I think that's really bizarre. And I think so if you face, as an international investor, you face the Netherlands, you will find that kind of people, so which are really open, but which are also really direct. I think we are in the Netherlands, also being in a lot of boards of European companies, I know that we, as also colleague VCs, we are known as pretty direct. So we don't like a lot of politics. We like to be direct. When we see something we like, we mention it. But if we don't like it, we also mention it.
So does that cause any issues? So if you have a go global mindset from the beginning, but still might have a way to communicate that might not necessarily go with other cultures? Have you seen it?
Oh, I agree. So that's something we all have to work on. But if I know that a lot of founders talk to international VCs and try to struggle with that. So I think if you are an international VC targeting Netherlands, you'll be facing that. And you will face people who are really, I think, pretty well English spoken. Sorry, they like to speak the English language also, but they also like to be direct in the feedback also if they have things they do like and don't like. So I think that's typically for the Netherlands and for the culture, and also related to startups. There's a massive, of course, I think in maturity, the landscape is pretty sophisticated already. I think also due to the success of companies like IGN and Booking, etc., and MessageBird recently, etc. So a lot of very good successes, and we see that also in international VCs coming to the Netherlands. So we personally, I think we have a reach out of every week to international from other continents, also VCs want to discuss deal flow with us. So there's a lot of appetite for international VCs for the Dutch companies to invest in.
And now in Porto, Adao, you've also, or in Portugal in total, you've also worked with international investors investing in Portugal. Is there any kind of challenges you noticed that you have to help them through? For example, you mentioned that the sales side might be lacking sometimes in Portugal. Do you have to kind of see through not that polished pitches to see the actual value behind it?
I think, I mean, what you say, Mar, it's true regarding the sales and marketing, like I mentioned, but I think that the challenges itself have more to do with unknown than with the known part, in my opinion. But if we are talking about some typical challenges like language, I would say the same applies as Netherlands. I must tell you that is not an issue at all. The major part of the population in Portugal speaks Portugal, at least the more youngest one, I would say, and until the age of 4 years, they all speak English. Okay. Bureaucracy, yes, you will find it, but the same applies for other countries, I suppose. Corporate law might be different, but is very straightforward, in my opinion. It might take you some hours eventually to understand some things, but it's really simple. So, in my opinion, nothing to be really afraid of. Actually, there's a serious challenge that is the food and the weather. Most likely, you will be addicted to them. just being funny. But yeah, regarding the sales and marketing, what you said is true. We lack that kind of skills. But I think that the best way for an outside investor to familiarize with the new startup environment and overcome challenges is to have some guidance and support, just like tourist guides, you know? You don't know the places where to go, so better ask for help. For VCs, I would say, for international VCs, I would say that local VCs and even the founders themselves are the best alternative for guiding them. And at least is what we do abroad, despite our focus. The focus of Portugal Ventures in terms of investment is 90-95% in Portugal. But yeah, for the only self-investors that are watching us right now, I make myself immediately available for any assistance that they might need regarding Portugal. And on behalf of Johan, let me tell you, the Netherlands people are very sharp and very direct. I can confirm you this because we had the venture together a few years ago, and I can totally confirm this. It's absolutely true.
Yeah.
The directness?
Yeah.
Sorry, what you said, Leon?
Did it help you, the directness? Is it?
It helped. It caused some issues, but looking back, it was better that way, to be honest. Yeah, so it's a good thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And my experience as an expat here in Amsterdam, I think it's also a good thing to know of it beforehand. Then it's really helpful because it can kind of cause a bit of collisions if you don't know about this method. But as soon as you kind of accept that, it kind of facilitates the whole communication a lot easier.
Yeah, absolutely. That VCs, when there are top things on the table, then they reach out beforehand to us and they ask us to discuss it, right? Because we're probably on the tables. Yeah.
But yeah, so Adao kind of came into a bit of the support measures that our investors can look for in these cities. So is there anything in particular you would recommend to Johan in Amsterdam?
Yeah, I think as mentioned, we have a really mature system. So also, you know, launching a company and helping from banks, I think it's very, very standardized, really good organized also, so very low barriers there. There's a lot of support from the Dutch government, of course, like the call in Portugal. We also have it in the Netherlands, and it's very also well adapted and well taken off, being managed in this case by the regional development agencies or the regional venture funds. In the Netherlands, we have TechLeap, which you probably know, which is a non-profit for startup, headed by the Prince of the Netherlands. And so that helps, of course, to generate a lot of PR, but he's really, Constantijn, also a good guy in helping startups and opening doors for, you know, measurements, but also how we can decrease labor costs, get more favorable options, etc. So I think that's really good, it's helping. And I think a lot of events are happening right now, you know, like the Next Web is doing, but also like other players, also the government, Speak Capital, we have a lot of open office hours, but also Ask Me Anything hours specifically for companies which are in big trouble, also bringing back our value and giving back to the entrepreneurial society in the Netherlands. So I think it's really good, and everybody's really open to help other companies.
Yeah. And Johan came, so mentioned the government there. I've seen a lot of initiatives come out of Portugal, Adal. So do you feel like the government is a big help in these matters?
Yeah, absolutely. Indeed. And I didn't mention this, but Portugal Ventures is a public venture capitalist. So in a way, we are already an instrument for public policies regarding investment. But in what regards to the investment, I think Portugal is doing a really good work in reaching out to international community. It does that in terms of communication, but also in practical terms. And what I mean by practical terms is, for example, investing money through a matching fund named 200M fund that is 200 million fund. Also, Portugal Ventures is instrumental in this investment policies. And additionally, I think that Portugal's public policies are becoming more and more geared towards fostering entrepreneurship. One, for example, is the Startup Portugal initiative that basically is working for a thriving entrepreneurship community. It operates as a medium between government, entrepreneurs, incubators, accelerators, and also investors. And if you want to check it out, go to startupportugal.com and you will find tons of relevant and handy information. Other existing initiatives are the ones like Scale Up Port and Startup Amsterdam that indeed are promoting this chat we are having right now. And also, of course, another, you know, independent events like Web Summit, where the Portuguese government made a huge pressure to bring this event here to Portugal. And for what I know, it will continue for the next years. Let's see if in remote or in presence. Let's see.
Yeah, I think we're all looking forward to being back. So, I mean, remote events are great, but it's also nice to meet up in person. And I think, I think we're all excited to see kind of these ecosystems blend a bit more and become perhaps more unified, but also just a bigger understanding between different ecosystems. So people won't be afraid to kind of reach out.
Right.
But unfortunately, that's all the time we have for now. Thank you so much, Adao and Johan, for joining us here today. And for
You're
sharing
welcome.
Your insights into these ecosystems.
Welcome. Yeah. Thanks for having me.